Good morning. Thank you for being here today, and thank you all the guest speakers for setting our invitation. We will now go on the first session under the theme Identities and Culture. Firstly, I would like to really introduce the three guest speakers of this panel, Professor Pierre Bosset from Université du Québec à Montréal, Professor Maxime Saint-Hilaire from Université de Sherbrooke, and Professor Letizia Mancini from Università degli Studi di Milano. Pierre Bosset is a professor of public law at the University of Quebec in Montreal, UK, Department of Legal Sciences, LLM in Human Rights, Essex, and International Relations, Cambridge. He has worked in the non-governmental sector before joining in 1985 the Quebec Human Rights Commission, where he has conducted several studies on the legal accommodation of cultural and religious diversity. He has addressed issues such as the wearing of religious symbol in the school and has significant impact on Quebec society and public policy. Since 2007, he teaches at Duquesne on human rights, constitutional law, and public international law. He is also interested in the relation between law and the arts. He has been a member of the advisory commission of Bouchard Taylor Commission, as well as working group on cultural and religious diversity established by the Quebec Ministry of Education and the Council of Europe. His presentation today is titled Systemic Transformation Through Human Rights, Institutional versus Judicial Strategies in Quebec. Maxime Saint-Hilaire is a professor at the Faculty of Law in the Université de Sherbrooke since 2010. He was a researcher at Marc Bloch Center in Berlin, CMB, and at the Center for Research in Ethics at the University of Montreal, CAUM, where he also taught comparative constitutional law as a lecturer. A former trainee of the European Commission for Democracy through Law, he also worked in Supreme Court for Canada in 2009 and 2010 as a law clerk to the Honorable Marie Deschamps. Professor Saint-Hilaire is a member of the advisory board of the Institute of Parliamentary and Political Law, as well as the Editorial Committee of the Parliamentary and Political Law Review. His presentation today is under the title, Can the Philosophy of Recognition Make Sense of Claim for the Recognition of a Legal Order? Letizia Mancini is a professor of legal sociology and anthropology at Università degli Studi di Milano, where she belongs to the Doctoral School of Law. She has taught international masters in legal sociology and International Institute for Legal Sociology in Oñate, Basque Country. She also sits on the scientific and editorial board of the journal Sociologia del Diritto and has published extensively on multiculturalism and the law, culture and legal culture, human rights and minorities, including El Islam en Italia, Entre afirmación de identidad y reconocimiento de derechos fundamentales, La mediación culturale, Trattato sulla mediazione familiare, Diritti e forme della discriminazione, Il caso di Rome, and Burqa, Niqab, and Women's Rights. Her presentation today will be held in Spanish and has the title La relevancia penal del factor cultural, Reflexiones a partir del caso italiano. After all three presentations are complete, we will open a first round of questions, and in case there is some time left, we hope, there will also be a second round. We will now start with Professor Pierre Bosset and his presentation. Thank you.
Muchas gracias. Buenos días a todos. Es un placer estar aquí, but I have to speak in English. Please bear with me. Okay, I chose this subject having in mind that the concerns of the organizers was to deal with the relationships between civil society, government institutions, and human rights, and how those actors interact. So I chose to focus on a comparison between legal strategies and institutional strategies in Quebec for achieving systemic change based on human rights. And I'm going to start with this image, which was taken from a website in Quebec. This website is sponsored by a group that is asking for the Quebec government to organize a public commission on systemic racism. And as you can see from the image, for the organizers of that website, racism is systemic, therefore the solution has to be collective. And this has become a very controversial topic in Quebec at the moment. And there is a basis for that. There are hints that discrimination and maybe racism exist in Quebec and in Canada as well, despite the image of Quebec and Canada as an exemplary society. For example, the rates of incarceration for blacks in Quebec and Canada in general is generally higher than for other groups. The same applies to First Nations or Indigenous Nations. Unemployment much higher for those groups too. They are underrepresented in the civil service, in elected positions, and in generally speaking in arts and culture. So there are reasons for that demand for a collective solution to discrimination and racism. And this is another website from a newspaper. It has become urgent to create a commission on systemic racism in Quebec. So I'm going to come back to that later on. But first I want to emphasize the general picture for dealing with discrimination and racism in Quebec. And I'll come back to racism at the end. So I think it's useful to differentiate between different approaches for dealing with discrimination and racism. This is a bit artificial, I know, but it's convenient and certainly useful. So you have an educational approach, there is a political approach, a political struggle approach, and there is, finally, what I call the law-based approach, which, of course, can take the form of judicial action, okay, action in court, but also, and this is what I want to emphasize today, it can also take the form of dialogue with public institutions. And I'm going to deal with this specifically this morning. So, first, judicial strategies, okay, court actions. There is a legal framework that you have to keep in mind, and I try to present it on this slide here. So, if there is a case of discrimination, then it is up to the Human Rights Commission, the Quebec Human Rights Commission, to investigate that situation. And eventually, the commission can take that case to the Human Rights Tribunal. This is how it works. Okay, so two phases, an investigation by the Human Rights Commission, and then a court decision by the Human Rights Tribunal, which are two different entities. Okay, what have we achieved in Quebec through judicial action regarding racism and discrimination? Well, about 25% of the total number of investigations of the Human Rights Commission are based on race, color, or ethnic and racial origin, and about 3% based on religion. If you compare with other grounds, such as disability, for example, which represent 40%, you can see that about roughly 25% of the total number of cases investigated deal with racism or discrimination based on religion. That's quite a large amount of cases every year. What have we gained through judicial action so far in Quebec? Well, a number of significant gains. For example, in 1985, more than 30 years ago, the courts recognized the concept of reasonable accommodation, which has now become a common word in Quebec, and it's gradually spreading in other countries as well. There is strong interest in reasonable accommodation in European countries at the moment. So this is a gain that was obtained through court action back in the 1980s, and which came from the United States, by the way. It was imported into Canadian law by the courts, but it was then significantly expanded by the Canadian courts. At the same period, we recognized the notion of systemic discrimination. Systemic discrimination is not based on racism or discriminatory intent. It is based on the impact of practices over time. This has nothing to do with being a bad person. You know, even well-meaning people can be found responsible for that kind of discrimination, because it has nothing to do with what you, how you think. It has to do with what, how, what you do and the impact of what you do on people. Another example is that the employers in Quebec, private or public, are legally responsible for discrimination that occurs through their employees or even through their clients. So this is, this has been a significant development in the mid-1990s. The so-called preferences of clients are not an excuse for discrimination. Another gain. Racial profiling, the way that police identify people based on their appearance and arrest them or interrogate them, this is called racial profiling. It is now recognized in Quebec law thanks to a court decision that goes back to 2005. And I could go on like this. I also want to emphasize that those court decisions feed the other types of action, the other strategies that I mentioned earlier, in particular, the educational strategies. Okay. Educators use those legal gains to educate people about racism and discrimination. So there is an interaction between the various strategies that I outlined at the beginning. Okay, so now there are also criticisms of the judicial approach, strong criticisms. One of them is that the investigations by the Human Rights Commissions are very long. The average delay is 15 months, which is a lot. But some cases go up to 3 or 4 years. So that this is becoming a big problem, and it's been going on for years, this issue of delays in investigations. We also notice that the cases that deal with race and religion to some extent are more often closed by the commission than those based on disability or gender, for example. Why is that? This is a phenomenon that can be observed throughout Canada, not just in Quebec. Why does this happen? There are a number of studies about that. And one of the reasons invoked is that the staff at the Human Rights Commissions throughout Canada are not sufficiently sensitive to racism issues. Many staff members are, in fact, like me, white people who do not have a personal experience of racism and discrimination. So in a way, this is a problem of training that has to be solved. Similarly, Human Rights Commissions tend to focus on discrimination grounds, individually speaking, rather than trying to integrate their analysis. They do not pay sufficient attention to the concept of intersectionality, the combination of grounds of discrimination. And perhaps the most significant criticism is that those judicial gains do not have a systemic impact. They have an impact on one or two employers, specifically speaking, but they do not have an impact on society at large. So what I'm going to do now is try to examine alternative approaches to judicial action, namely institutional approaches. And I'm going to deal with three different institutional strategies. One of them, which is undertaken by the same Human Rights Commission that investigates, is called systemic investigations. The Commission has the power to do that. The Commission can open an investigation file on systemic or global issues rather than on one specific situation. It does not do that very often because it takes time, it takes money, it takes staff. So there have been, I think, 3 or 4 systemic investigations only during the last 40 years. Those two examples here are perhaps the most well-known. There was a systemic investigation in the 1980s regarding racial discrimination in the taxi business. And there was a second one a few years after on discrimination in the relationships between police and minority groups. It's interesting to see why those investigations took place and what they achieved in the end. What were the triggers and outcomes? In the case of the taxi industry, the trigger was that the commission had received several, in fact many, individual complaints of discrimination, but those investigations had no impact on the actual situation. So in the end, the commission decided it was worthwhile to undertake a systemic investigation on its own initiative. In the case of police, the second investigation, the death of a young black man was the immediate cause, okay, so tragedy. Which triggered public interest in the media and which NGOs, human rights NGOs, took upon to ask the commission to initiate an investigation, which it did. Both consultations in the end revealed the extent of discrimination taking place, and the recommendations in the end have led to significant changes in the practices of the taxi business, of the police itself, the standards used in those industries, training of police officers, and even in the laws and regulations. So those investigations were successful, but it took tragedies and long-standing discrimination to start those investigations. The second example I want to give you is perhaps the most interesting from my point of view. It is not an investigation as such, it is called public consultation. This is something that the Commission also has the power to initiate. And the most successful example of consultation was the one that took place about 20 years ago regarding discrimination against gays and lesbians. Now, if you take a similar approach to police and taxi, you ask yourself why and what did it achieve? What were the triggers and the outcomes? In that case, the triggers were many. Sexual orientation already was a prohibited ground of discrimination in Quebec since 1977. In the 1980s, the AIDS crisis occurred. And that revealed the indifference of the health authorities in Quebec towards the issue. And this is something that gays and lesbians took conscience of over the years. At the same period, there were a few homophobic murders and incidents of gay bashing in restaurants, bars. The police didn't act properly in those cases, and that was one of the triggers also. Eventually, the lesbians and gay leaders asked the commission to start an investigation, a systemic investigation. The commission decided not to do that. Instead, it chose to undertake a public consultation. And to make sure that the consultation would work, the commission dialogued with the lesbians and gay leaders. Okay, so the whole consultation project was designed by a joint committee of the commission and community leaders. And this was important because it ensured the success of the consultation, as I will mention a bit later. That committee identified health, police, and legislation as key issues for consultation. The consultations were widely reported by the media, even on television. And eventually, the report contained no less than 41 recommendations, which have led to significant changes here again in policy, including the legal recognition of same-sex couples in Quebec law, in Quebec civil law. So, how to explain the relative success of the consultation? Well, to me, the most important factor is that the project was so-called co-constructed by the community itself, by the concerned community. This was something that the commission did quite seriously. I was working for the commission at the time, but I wasn't involved in that case. But I observed what was going on, and I could tell that my colleagues were really seriously willing to engage with community leaders to make sure that the consultation would work, and that it would not be imposed from top down. It was co-constructed. What helped was that the Human Rights Commission is independent from government. It is publicly funded. But once the funding has come, the commission can do whatever it wants. It can criticize government authorities. which it does very often. And that raised the credibility of the Commission in the eyes of the community. In fact, a climate of confidence was established between the Commission and community leaders, as was pointed out by two of my colleagues in a paper published in 2007. Also, since there was a climate of confidence, then the community leaders had no problem encouraging the members of their communities to take part in the consultation. So many people showed up at the consultations, giving testimonies of their own personal experience with discrimination. And this created a kind of buzz in the media. The media reported on those cases very sympathetically, empathically also. And this created a kind of climate where it became sort of mainstream to advocate for lesbian and gay issues. But, however, behind all that, there was the threat of legal action concerning the recognition of same-sex couples. Political actors were aware that at the same time, in parallel, there was a court case going on where the non-recognition of same-sex couples in the Quebec Civil Code was challenged under non-discrimination, under equality. So you cannot totally separate the consultation and legal action. I think the legal action or the threat of legal action reinforced the consultation. The third kind of institutional approach I want to talk about is sui generis. It has nothing to do with investigation or public consultation within the meaning of the Human Rights Commission. And it is a well-known example, even in Europe, of the Bouchard-Taylor Commission on Reasonable Accommodation of Cultural Differences, which was mentioned earlier. The triggers for the creation of the commission were totally different. In 2006, the Supreme Court of Canada decided a controversial case called the Mutani case, which had to do with the wearing of a kirpan, a ceremonial knife, which is worn by Sikhs in the school context. Okay, so a 12-year-old boy wore a kirpan under his trousers. And some parents objected to that on grounds of security. The school board authorities initially allowed the boy to wear the kirpan, but in the face of protests from parents, eventually changed their mind and told him, no, if you want to wear your kirpan, go to a different school, which he did, by the way. He left the public school system and went to a private school. But his case was brought to courts and eventually it reached the highest level, the Supreme Court of Canada, which ruled in favor of that boy. And this created in the media a backlash, a negative reaction, which was taken on by most media, leading to what one of my colleagues, Maïs Potmeyas, called the crisis of reasonable accommodation, the crisis in perceptions. Some politicians found it convenient to use this as a political issue. And in the end, the government of the time decided to diffuse the issue by creating a sui generis consultation on reasonable accommodation, the Bouchard-Taylor Commission. And the Bouchard-Taylor Commission could have dealt with the problem on strict technical grounds. It could have consulted on reasonable accommodation, technically speaking. That would have been safe. Instead, they chose, without being forced, but they chose to broaden the issue and to organize a consultation on integration in Quebec, on interculturalism, on laïcité, and so on. So the issue, the technical issue of reasonable accommodation became almost an existential issue. And this caused problems because eventually the commission was very popular in terms of media. Many people showed up on live television, but the commission also heard very frightening things coming from ordinary people who let steam off against immigrants, against religious minorities, and so on. It wasn't a pretty thing to watch. What happened to the report? Well, another colleague of mine, François Rocher, has tried to classify the 49 recommendations of the report. Some recommendations were technical, instrumental. They dealt with recognizing the skills and qualifications of immigrants, for example, the learning of French, and so on. Some were humanistic. They dealt with human dignity, racism, and discrimination, which is what concerns us this morning. Diversity, cross-cultural dialogue, and so on. And some dealt with citizenship. What is social cohesion? What are the common values, which have already been discussed earlier today? What is the rule of law? What means participation, and so on? And the same writer, François Rocher, has suggested that the instrumental or technical recommendations were more or less followed, eventually, by government, but that the most politically controversial ones, at your right, were not so much followed. So the overall assessment of the Bouchard-Taylor Commission is mixed, and I can say this with no problem, even though I was part of the consultation committee. I didn't have much influence on the way the two commissioners chose to organize the consultations. So I have no problem in saying that the record of the commission is mixed. We cannot be very, very positive about that commission. In fact, my colleague Rocher, once again, wrote this, I translated, "It would seem that public authorities have devoted more efforts to the instrumental dimension of diversity than to what appeared to be behind the creation of the Bouchard-Taylor Commission, the identity problem." Okay, so now I'm coming back to the issue of systemic racism. What remains to be discussed regarding that eventual commission on systemic racism? Well, should it deal with racism or with discrimination? Discrimination is a legal concept. Racism is not. So are you going to consult about one or the other? The risk, if you choose to consult on racism, is that the consultation will go in every direction and will perhaps end up in blaming people. Whereas if you choose to consult on discrimination, then you don't have to worry about intentions or state of mind. Remember, systemic racism does not refer to intent or racism. It has nothing to do with racism. But the issue is still very ongoing at the moment. What kind of commission would it be? Would it have investigation powers, or would it be a consultation based on voluntary initiative? Okay, will people be forced to testify, or will they be invited? What kind of consultation? Who will you consult? And which aspects will you cover? Police, education, health, society in general? So those are all key issues. And there are discussions going on at the moment. I'm not part of those discussions, so I don't know what will be decided eventually. But there is a committee formed by government to discuss specifically those issues. In the end, my conclusion is the following. What are the potential and the preconditions for success for institutional approaches? Based on the experience we have, a few things to say, five or six. I think we can fairly say that institutional strategies can promote systemic change. This is quite apparent from the investigations on police minorities, issues, taxi discrimination, and specifically gay and lesbian discrimination. So systemic change can be achieved through non-judicial measures. Okay. They can also have a mobilizing effect on communities. This was very clear in the gay and lesbian consultation. They can have an educational impact on deciders, on political authorities, on government, on members of parliament, and on society in general. They can be, they are not always, but they can be combined with legal strategies. Remember that the consultation on gays and lesbians took place with the threat of legal action in the background. but they work best when those strategies involve independent public institutions, independent from government. So there has to be that trust between the community and the entity that organizes the consultation. And what I want to emphasize at the end is that they work best when they are co-constructed with the people directly concerned. So I'm not saying these are the only conditions, and I'm not saying that those conditions will ensure the success of institutional strategies, but I think they have to be kept in mind. Thank you.